say, you know, I.
May Board of Education meeting.
There you go.
Well, first, call the meeting to order.
We need some motion.
To take the roll?
Take the roll. Or do I just take the roll?
Just take the roll.
Yep, thank you.
Member Cassidy?
Here.
Member Beeftink?
Here.
Member Arms?
Here.
Member Silverstack?
Here.
Member Weinstock?
Here.
President Gallenson?
Here.
And Member Basil is absent.
And we'll stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The first order of business is a public hearing for the School Improvement Day waiver application. Do we have a motion to open the School Improvement Day waiver application hearing?
So moved.
Second.
Would you please call the roll?
Sure. Member Cassidy?
Aye.
Member Silverstack?
Aye.
Member Beeftink?
Aye.
Member Arms?
Aye.
Member Weinstock?
Aye.
And President Gallenson?
Aye.
And absent is Basil.
Okay, well, thank you. So just some information. The public hearing notice for this hearing was posted on our website and posted in the paper in the Northbrook Star on May the 11th, 2023, as required by school code. The purpose of this public hearing is actually to determine whether the board approves our waiver application for full-day school improvement days, which is pursuant to Section 2.3.25G of the Illinois School Code. So currently, we are able, under the school calendar, to have half-day school improvement days where students are in attendance for half-day, and then they are out of school the other half of the day for school improvement work with staff. In particular, we're applying for this waiver because, as you know, the election day is now, elections are now being held in schools across the state, and so because they're able to use our school buildings, we want to be able to be to have students out of school on election day and have staff do staff development that day. So this will be allow us to do that as a full day. We also, of course, this would give us flexibility in the future to have full day school improvement days if we so choose to schedule them in our calendar as opposed to half days.
Any questions from the board? No. And as it's a public hearing, do we have any comments from the public? Do we have a motion to close the hearing?
So moved.
Second.
Would you please call the roll?
Member Arms?
Aye.
Member Silverstack?
Aye.
Member Weinstock?
Aye.
Member Cassidy?
Aye.
Member Beeftink?
Aye.
And President Gallenson?
Aye.
And then absent is Basil.
Next, we'll hold visitors' comments. Would anyone like to speak this evening? Okay. Hearing none, there's a presentation for the Health Education Blue Ribbon.
Yes, thank you. So we are excited tonight to be recognizing Northbrook Junior High teacher, health teacher Wendy Conklin, for receiving the Blue Ribbon Award for Excellence in Health Education from the Illinois Health Association and the Illinois Association for Health, or School Health Association, and Illinois Association for Health, Physical Education, Recreation, and Dance. This recognition actually comes after Ms. Conklin submitted a detailed application, and we had two representatives from the state organizations visit our school to interview teachers, administration, students, and parents. The focus of the award is the health education our students receive. Each student participates in 9 weeks of health education each year. Ms. Conklin has built this curriculum from the ground up using multiple resources. to develop customized, age-appropriate coursework at each grade level. Health education focuses on health promotion, wellness prevention, maintenance of positive health, and complies with all of our state standards. In addition to the health curriculum, NBJH was also noted for focusing on resources for the whole child and offering diverse extracurricular activities. The state wrote in that this variety gives every student the opportunity to be seen, valued for their contribution, attitudes, attributes, and talents. Ms. Conklin and NBJH will be recognized at the Illinois Association for Health, Physical Education, Recreation, and Dance Association on November the 30th. At this time, I'd like to invite Ms. Conklin to the microphone to say a few words.
I am going to read this because I'm afraid I'll forget some things. I am very proud of this program. It is 20 years in the making, and I'm still tinkering with it, as Scott said today. But I gotta say that meeting the students' health and wellness needs is such a team effort. We have amazing social workers, school nurses, support staff at Northbrook Junior High. The teachers work very hard to implement social-emotional literacy lessons in X-Block and in their classes and in their curriculum. Our cafeteria is really bar none. It's amazing. And they provide fresh and healthy options for our students and staff. We have clubs, sports, and activities that help meet specific needs and help build the sense of community that every human craves. So one of the other bright spots is that we have a board and administrators who value health and wellness enough to encourage and fund these programs. So I feel very lucky to work here. And this ribbon, Blue Ribbon Award, is truly for all of us.
Congratulations. Thank you so much for your dedication to the program. And we have an award for you, a certificate of recognition on behalf of the board.
Thank you.
Do you want a photo?
Yes.
Do you want me to come?
Sure. Go on the other side.
Next, we'll have the superintendent's report.
Thank you so much. Just a couple of reminders. In your board packet is the enrollment report for April, so you have that information. Our current enrollment is 1,880 students. We did have 11 new students enroll in the month of April. Just a couple of reminders about the board calendar. Our June meeting, which is on the 20th of June, actually starts at 5:30. We have our regular meeting at 5:30, and then of course afterwards you have your board workshop with Dignity Consulting. So I wanted to remind you of that as well. Tonight, we are actually gonna be updating our school calendar. As I mentioned earlier, we have been notified that our schools will be used on March the 19th of 2024 as a site for polling places. As you probably know, that will be a presidential primary, and so because it's a presidential primary, we anticipate maybe higher than normal traffic for those elections. And so we have adjusted the calendar so that we can be out of school on the 19th. And so in your packet, we actually have that amended calendar, and I want to just talk you through the changes that were made as part of that process. So the first thing that happened is we are actually swapping our January 12th half day school improvement day for the 19th. So instead of a half day on the 12th, we're going to do it on the 19th of March. So you'll see that on the 12th of January, we'll have a regular attendance day for students. It is still a no student day for YE. They're on a little bit of a different schedule. But it will now be a full day of school for students in K-8. Also on here, inadvertently, we had scheduled parent-teacher conferences on the 14th of February and the 15th of February. As you can imagine, I don't think people are very interested in having parent conferences on Valentine's Day. So we just made a slight adjustment there and moved the first day for conferences to the 13th, which would be Tuesday evening instead of Wednesday the 14th. And of course, the other day for conferences will be the 15th, which is Thursday. And then you'll see there indicated on the calendar that the March 19th election day will be no school for all students. And we, of course, are applying for the all-day school improvement day waiver from the state. It will hopefully be approved. There's no reason to believe that it will not be. And that will be a full-day school improvement day on the 19th. Are there any questions about the changes to the calendar? Well, we can come back to that in just a minute. Let's finish.
Anything on the calendar? All right, thank you for being responsive. I know we had a lot of parent requests and feedback regarding the schools being open on that day. So thank you for accommodating.
So because this is a change to the calendar, this is actually an action item. So if we can get a motion in a second.
Do we have a motion to approve the calendar as revised?
So moved.
Second.
Great. Member Arms?
Aye.
Member Beef Tank?
Aye.
Member Cassidy?
Aye.
Member Silvershack?
Aye.
Member Weinstock?
Aye.
President Gallinson?
Aye.
And absent is Baser.
Okay, great. And you mentioned that you had a question, Member Arms?
Yeah, sorry, I didn't send this ahead of time. 11 new students in the month of April seems like a lot. So my question is just, it seems unusual. So do we know like what's going on?
Sure, so that's a really good question. So really almost half of them, five of them were from Young Explorers. Because as you know, we have rolling enrollment. So when a student turns three, they actually become eligible for services in our Young Explorers program. So five of those students were Young Explorers. There were actually two students at Greenbrier that joined us in April, as well as four students at Meadowbrook.
Thank you.
Next, we have approval of minutes for the regular meeting April 25th and closed meeting April 25th. Does anyone have any changes or feedback on the minutes? No? So it is an action item. Do we have a motion to approve the minutes?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, Member Silvershack?
Aye.
Member Cassidy?
Aye.
Member Beef Tank?
Aye.
Member Arms?
Aye.
Member Weinstock?
Aye.
And President Gallinson?
Aye.
Along with Member Baser is absent.
Next is the approval of the consent agenda. Does anyone have anything to pull out of the consent agenda? I reviewed the bills and met with Jessica, and everything was in order. Any other questions or comments? Is there a motion to approve the consent agenda?
So moved.
Second.
Great. Member Weinstock?
Aye.
Member Arms?
Aye.
Member Silvershack?
Aye.
Member Baser is absent. Member Cassidy?
Aye.
Member Beef Tank?
Aye.
And President Gallinson?
Aye. Next, we'll move on to the staff and committee reports. Jessica, do you have the financial report?
I do. Thank you. Good evening. So in your board packet were the financial reports for the month ended April 30th, 2023, as well as the bills that were just approved and reviewed. Thank you. After 10 months of operation in this fiscal year, our monthly variance shows 77% of the current year's budget expended, which is pretty in line with our prior years, but over 100% of our budgeted revenues collected, which is primarily due to another unprecedented year of the corporate personal property replacement taxes receipts. They exceeded the initial estimates from the Department of Revenue. Our food service sales through the end of April totaled $364,715. That's compared to just under $150,000 at the same time last year. So as we've predicted and have seen, as we come further and further out of the pandemic, we're back to a very normal in terms of receipts in the kitchen, as well as a little bit of ahead where we were prior. So for the month of April, we had a profit of just over $200. We are still running a year-to-date operating deficit of $6,417. That's due to the inflation and rising cost of food and the staffing down there. We didn't raise our prices in conjunction with those inflationary pieces. It's a hint to preview for an item maybe for next month. But just to put it in perspective too, the deficit this time last year was over $76,000. So the cafeteria program is meant to be a break-even program. It's not meant to profit. So operating a slight deficit is just fine. Are there any questions about the finance report?
That is an action item. Do we have a motion to approve the financial report?
So moved.
Second.
Member Cassidy?
Aye.
Member Silvershack?
Aye.
Member Weinstock?
Aye.
Member Beefeater?
Aye.
Member Arms?
Aye.
President Gallinson?
Aye.
And absent is Member Baser.
Next is Human Resources. Edward.
Good evening. I just want to share, as we conclude the school year, we are still actually hiring substitute teachers. So we're looking forward to sharing an update of all the new substitutes we hired at our June meeting, and what preparations we're making for the fall and getting ready for the next school year. And that's all at this time. Thank you.
Thank you. Teaching and learning. We have a presentation today on science resources and world language first. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. Michelle Jackson and I are excited to share with you some progress that we've made on science and world language. When we met with you in March, we talked a bit about the curriculum review process, and because we have a few new members, we did want to review that process with you before we jump into the decisions that have been made. So one of the things to think about when we are thinking about the process that we have in place here in our school district is the importance of building coherence from grade level to grade level so that kids have a cohesive experience, so that the experiences that they have as they start in early childhood connect to those that they have through the elementary schools, through the junior high, and onto the high school. So when we put committees together, we have representation from all levels, and we ask teachers to bring their expertise from their grade level experiences, but to think more broadly about how the experiences of students can come together and be improved based on the conversations and collaboration that we have as a committee. This just shows our timeline for working on curriculum. It's typically about a 6 or 7 year process. The first 2 years of the process are when we bring that committee together, again, representation from early childhood through high school, and we do learning together. We learn about best practices in the field, about the newest research related to a content area. We think about the experiences that students are having currently in the content area. We do a study of the perceptions of parents and families and students and staff members in the curricular area. And we think about the strengths and the areas for improvement in the curricular area, which takes us into year two, which is where we make decisions about curriculum, which is resources, as well as assessments that we're going to use, as well as things like course pathways, which is how quickly students are moving through curriculum, as well as use of time. Then in year three, the committee helps us to plan that implementation, the first year implementation of a new curriculum, and that includes input from committee members around professional development that's needed to support teachers, as well as creating documents that schools can use so that they can reflect on the level of implementation and places where schools might want to support continued professional development at their school level. And we also think about parent communication and parent involvement and how to make sure that families are understanding the new curricular changes and what their kids are experiencing.
Hey, Chris, can I ask a question?
Sure.
So when you say professional development, does that essentially equate to like training of what might be new for the teachers?
Sure.
So it's not optional, it would be required.
You know, there's a piece of it that's really training. And training, you could think about it as bringing the resource to teachers and helping them learn how to use the resource. But there's also sort of wrapping around a bigger idea of professional learning. And professional learning really encompasses like not only how are we implementing the resource, but then taking student work and what are students showing us in terms of their responses to the learning that's happening in the classroom and how are we responding to that. So it's sort of the training piece. Everybody needs to know how to implement the new curriculum. But it's also making sure that in our systems, whether it's our learning teams or our department conversations or conversations with principals, that we just continue to learn around that resource, kids' response to the resource, and then make the adjustments. So it's sort of more than a one-time thing. It's also thinking about how the system supports deep implementation and ongoing revisions. Great question. Okay, let's take a peek at science and see where we are. So some decisions were made since we're in ending year two of our science committee work. And this highlights some of the areas for improvement. So again, we don't just think about like adopting a program. We also think about things like course pathways and time. So as we looked at time and the amount of time that students were receiving science instruction, over the last few years, because of the impact of the pandemic, it's been tough to carve out time for science and social studies instruction. So we worked with the principals, took another look at the master schedules at the schools, and set a goal of finding at least 45 minutes, 40 to 45 minutes in each classroom each day to teach science and social studies. And so we were able to do that with some creativity with the principals and just sort of some tweaking and tightening up master schedules. So each child will have 40 to 45 minutes this coming year of science and social studies instruction. On top of that, students in grades 2 through 5 will also have STEM learning time. So 18 times a year, times 45 minutes, students will be engaged in STEM learning. So much like we have at the junior high, students will have not only robust science instruction from their classroom teachers, but on top of that, they'll also have some STEM learning time. So we're excited about those improvements. We also have some pieces of the instructional model and the curricular plan that we're excited about. Specifically, working with the high school and thinking about a really important tool that scientists use, a science notebook. And Mary Rockroar and science teachers from GBN were very gracious to share with us the experiences that GBN students were having around science notebooking. And we thought about what that might look like at the junior high and what that might look like at the elementary school. So we've built a system, an instructional model, that's going to use that tool in a way that becomes very familiar to kids and a tool that will be very helpful, we think, in their science learning. And in addition, we also collaborated with our township colleagues to think about what they call 3D assessments. So the new Next Generation Science Standards have a model that they call 3D. It's three-dimensional. It's students learning content, but it's also how students think about the content, which is called the cross-cutting concepts, as well as what students do to engage in that learning, which is called the practices. So thinking again with the township collaboration, support from GBN, what those assessments will look like in our classrooms. So those were two big pieces of learning that we did and of improvements that will be forthcoming. This is a picture of the science vision that we have for students. And in that middle picture is two young scientists so excited about what they're learning. And that really became a goal for our science committee as we thought about the experiences we wanted for kids. Around the top is the idea that the Next Generation Science Standards was really built on the idea that kids are born investigators. When you think about that 3-year-old who runs outside and finds that ant hill and watches the ants and then pours some water in that ant hill to see what happens. We want that excitement and interest in the natural world to continue way beyond when they're 3 years old, through when all the way through high school onto junior high onto high school and beyond. So we want to take advantage of that idea that human beings are born investigators. And we want kids to see themselves as true scientists and engineers. So that means immersing them in doing what scientists and engineers do in the classroom. Lots of that is collaboration and discourse, because being a scientist or an engineer happens in a social environment where we learn from each other, where we ask questions of each other, where we engage in discourse, where we kind of have the push and pull of, I don't know if I agree with that, or that extends my thinking and helps me understand things differently. And then the idea that we're starting with the phenomenon, that we want kids to engage in seeing observable things in their world and wanting to understand those things better and realizing that science isn't about finding the right answer, because scientists and engineers don't work on known problems with known solutions. They work on the unknown. And so how can we make sure that in our classrooms our kids are really engaged in phenomenon, things that they wonder about and that they have questions about and that they want to learn about? So using the vision, then we made decisions specifically about our elementary science curriculum. So I'm going to turn it over to Michelle, who's going to talk about the decisions that were made for science adoption at the elementary level, and then she's going to segue into junior high.
So using this vision as our guide, we are recommending an adoption of a science program at elementary, and then we're going to talk about the revision work at MBJH that the team is doing around curriculum. So as we thought about curricular resources for elementary and the selection of a program, we wanted to make sure, just realized my microphone was off, sorry about that. So as we thought about the curricular resources and thinking about the selection of a program at elementary, we wanted to make sure that the resource we selected really put children at the center of learning. And when we look at this picture of these students who are engaging in a Smithsonian lesson, Smithsonian Science for the Classroom, you can see through their collaboration and the firsthand experiences that students are having with science learning, they're really making sense of a phenomenon as they're exploring. And one of the most powerful things that we see in the standards is that phenomenon is the idea of studying observable events. And we really want to bring those experiences and continue to bring those experiences to the forefront for students. And you can tell just by taking a look at this photo that these two students see themselves as scientists. They're not waiting for information to be told to them. They're doing the science, which truly what we know makes learning stick. And that was really important when we were thinking at the elementary level about bringing forward experiences for science learning. So we're really excited about Smithsonian Science for the Classroom. And some important points around this curricular program, this K-5 curricular program, is that when we reviewed materials, it showed consistent alignment to the next generation science standards. In addition, it also reflected really high features of quality designed programming. Things like scaffolding were present, the building of progressions. Dr. Raitzer talked earlier about the importance of that pre-K-12 and that coherence for students. And so when we were looking at features of high quality designed curriculums, building progressions is a really important thing for us to look at, as well as scientific accuracy, the relevance and authenticity of the phenomenon that students were experiencing, really making sense of the world around them. The other thing that Smithsonian showed was a strong assessment alignment to the expectations of the Illinois Learning Science Standards. So that was something also very important when we were reviewing curriculums. In addition, the committee visited Deerfield 109, who is implementing Smithsonian, and that allowed the science committee members to see the program in action and get the opportunity to talk to teachers who are teaching the resource. So
Smithsonian, just a little bit more around Smithsonian Science, is it was developed through the Smithsonian Education Center. So many of you probably are familiar with Smithsonian as an institution and the work that they do, as well as their education center. And so for each grade level in Smithsonian Science for the Classroom, there are four units that are fully aligned to the NGSS, which is the Next Generation Science Standards. And each grade level has a series of what's called storylines, as well as performance expectations. And Dr. Raitzer mentioned earlier, the ideas around the standards are these integration of the content, as well as what scientists and engineers do, as well as the ways in which we make sense, which is these cross-cutting concepts. Also, Smithsonian Science for the Classroom integrates literacy and math connections, which provides teachers with materials and children's books, with something else that we noted in each unit. Each unit has a guiding question that students explore. And across the unit, students are engaging in these firsthand experiences to make sense of phenomenon or engage in engineering design tasks. And each unit has a culminating challenge where students engage in either a science or an engineering task, which is really problem solving based. And the importance of that is it helps students be able to demonstrate their learning. So our recommendation for elementary is a purchase that will include the full program for grades K through 5. That includes print and digital teacher guides for that complete 3D, three-dimensional instruction, the assessment system, the print and digital student literacy tools, the print and digital student activity guides in grades 3 through 5. Those are great. They teach kids about criteria and constraints when they're thinking through engineering design and problem solving. Also the digital resources and the hands-on material kits. Really putting it at teachers' and kids' hands. Recently, when we were doing an initial training with teachers who weren't on committee, we talked about how, like, you're gonna get everything, like, right there in a kit, and they cheered. So they were so happy, like, oh, it's just gonna be all right there for me to bring these experiences to kids. There is also a digital platform that'll support teacher implementation and use while still really focusing on those firsthand experiences for students in science. And as Dr. Raitzer mentioned, Smithsonian Science for the Classroom also integrates students creating their own STEM notebooks. So that's another really important component of the particular program. You'll see here there is that yearly replenishment that'll help to make sure that we're bringing those consumables back into teachers' hands each year, year over year, so they can continue to bring these experiences to students. I want to take a few minutes to talk about the support for elementary teachers in implementation. And so the committee, another really important piece of the committee's work is they help to think through a plan for supporting their colleagues who aren't on the two-year committee. And so as we sort of thought through this, we wanted to think through supporting all elementary teachers as well as helping parents understand the new program. So we've created 12 hours of initial professional learning for teachers. The first 6 hours of the training replicate the learning that committee members did over the past 2 years. And then there's 6 hours for all teachers that's training specifically on the use of Smithsonian, so the logistics of the tools, the units, the resources, and things like that. We also know, and we're so lucky in this district, to have ongoing job-embedded teacher support, and we know how critical that is to implementation. So throughout the year, our instructional coaching team, as well as the STEM teachers, will meet with grade-level teams before units to unpack and think through the implementation of the lessons, and they'll also, which will really help teachers prepare for the unit, and they'll also support teachers in reviewing student work to assess student learning in science. Also during the curriculum committee work, we've developed what's called a look for document. We've done this in other instructional areas such as math. And this document helps to provide the building principal and the school leadership team with what implementation should look like and sound like in classrooms. And the importance of this document is that it helps school teams identify how they're going to continue to support teacher development and student learning. We'll also be updating the reporting standards to align to our new units and assessments, and that'll help support communication with families. And we're also working on developing family unit letters to provide updates to families across the year.
So now we want to talk about our amazing MBJH science team. And so the MBJH science teachers have been hard at work revising their curriculum this year. Because they're content specialists, they've been deeply immersed in the next generation science standards, the Illinois science standards, for quite a number of years. So their curriculum was already aligned, and so they really wanted to think through just refreshing their lessons and their assessments. So by working with our colleagues at GBN, the team has identified what they're calling VIPs, which are the valued instructional practices. And the goal is so that we can continue to ensure consistent and coherent experiences for students. Dr. Raitzer mentioned this earlier, but the team also has participated in learning with colleagues from across the township, which was led by GBN and GBS instructional supervisors, to really think through the improvement of their assessments and these three-dimensional assessments. This has been just such a huge success and so much for the team to be proud of. And it has led to really significant collaboration work for the teacher teams as well as for students. Just recently, one of the teacher teams was so excited about how they had redesigned an assessment. We actually ran into them in the kitchenette, and they were just so excited. They were like, you have to come up and visit our classrooms like today during 9th and 10th period. And so Dr. Raitzer and I popped up to 9th and 10th period that day to see classrooms. And what we saw for the assessment was kids interacting in a real life situation as if they were doctors. The students had all sorts of tools at hand. They had their science notebooks that they have worked so much to continue to develop. They had like an infographic, a reading passage, and their iPads, which technically meant they could Google information. But the assessment wasn't about answer finding. It was really about applying their learning to think through this particular medical condition and think about next steps. So what we saw students doing was constructing arguments. They were interpreting graphs. They were using models to explain their thinking. And even when there was a multiple choice answer or question that they were asked, there was actually potential for more than one answer to the question based on how they were interpreting the information and truly their explanation. And it was really interesting to watch them have to answer a multiple choice question based on the case study that they were investigating. I think the most powerful part in being able to have that opportunity also to reflect with the teacher teams is that it was so much more about what real scientists would do, and it was different than answer finding. We watched the kids flip through their notebooks and discuss information and really think about how they would take their learning and apply it. The teachers sat for quite some time after school and just were so proud and reflected on all they learned from watching the students take the assessment, as well as what they learned from looking at that student work together. And I think another powerful point was watching the access points that kids had to feel successful in that assessment. Kids talked about how like they didn't have to just memorize information for the test. One student actually commented the teacher, and again, this is an assessment, the student said, like, this was so fun, are we gonna do this tomorrow? And we don't oftentimes get that when we're talking about assessments with students. And so I think when we reflect on that, the teachers' planning was really a result of their collaborative learning that they've done for like the past 2 years together. And the department and their work together with Mary and GBN really led them to consider what revisions they will do next. So as soon as they were talking after school about this assessment, they were like, I think we should think about our previous unit and how we can redesign that assessment to really think through truly the work they're doing is this three-dimensional work to really give kids this opportunity to engage in science learning. And so next year, the junior high team will continue their awesome collaboration with GBN to think about the design of their lessons, assessments, and curricular resources. So that ends our science portion of this presentation. So we're happy to answer any questions that you might have at this time about science.
I have a couple of questions.
Sure.
You mentioned that the minutes for elementary science is increasing to 40 to 45 minutes per day. What was it, or science/social studies?
Yes. Yep.
What was it previously?
What is it now?
When we surveyed staff, and we surveyed them last year, so we were still, you know, coming out of the pandemic, it was anywhere they could carve out anywhere from 10 minutes to, at the most, it was like 45 minutes. And so as we looked at the experiences that we wanted for kids in the vision and Smithsonian, the expectations of Smithsonian, we knew we needed to get to 45.
So it's now a specific time frame, just like math is for ELA.
Right.
That's great.
Now it's part of the master schedule.
Also, my next question is there any discussion of the ISR program when you're talking about the science curriculum and revamping?
Yeah, so there are pieces when we do a curriculum review that we know are things we want to hold tight to that are highly successful, and that's one of those pieces that's been really highly successful for students, and so that's a piece that we'll hold tight to and continue with.
Thank
Following
you.
Up on the time, so given that it's inclusive of social studies, is the amount of time that's being cumulatively spent on social studies also increasing, and if so, is there extra content or changes to account for that?
Do you want to talk about maps, curriculum maps?
Sure. Yeah. So again, I think what we wanted to do is really bring that consistent block of time for teachers to be able to teach science and or social studies. And pre-pandemic, we had gone through revisions in social studies. And so over the past few years, as we've sort of navigated through the pandemic, we have continued to sort of make revisions to social studies programming, sort of like in that idea that Dr. Raitzer mentioned, like even when we were implementing, we're still revising and making given adjustments. So what by alternating units, what we'll be able to do is really continue to assess and look at our implementation of our social studies units and to see if there are places where we need to continue to make any of those additional revisions. So what teachers will do is they'll alternate science and social studies units across the year. They're not simultaneously teaching science and social studies units, and so they'll actually end up with four science units and they have three social studies units. So we worked with the committee. They looked at how many lessons social studies takes, how many lessons the science units takes, and certain units take a little bit of a different amount of time. You know, this given engineering design unit might require 10 days of lessons. So they looked at that, or 20 lessons or whatever it might be, to kind of decide where the amount of time they know right now they need for social studies and where they need for science fits and sits, to kind of scope out that sequence, if that makes sense. So it is something we'll take a look at to see, do we need to make any adjustments for social studies or science over time?
I'm sorry, that was a little confusing.
Yeah.
So the question was, if there's 45, if social studies and science are kind of, if science is now going to be a block, is social studies going to be the same block of time?
It is the same block of time, but they're not teaching. They're not teaching both social studies and science at the same time.
Yes, understood.
So it's like they do a social studies unit, then a science unit. And so what they had to do was look at the amount of time that each of those units takes to decide what made sense. We're going to start with social studies. It's going to need this many days.
Yes.
Then we're going to need this science unit. It'll be this many days.
I think the question was just like in a day.
Right.
Yes. Okay.
Yeah.
Yes,
so
you answer the question.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks.
Mm-hmm.
On the junior high levels, it's my understanding that STEM is a like elective course. Is that going to continue under the new sort of not program, but under the new model?
Yeah. And one of the things that we started to do is to look at that alignment of those student experiences. Mm-hmm. And as Dr. Raitzer mentioned, when we talk about this STEM lab and thinking about the time that our science lab STEM teachers will focus on things like coding, engineering, design, and things like that, it, you know, in collaboration with knowing what experiences that they move into at the middle school level, that was an important thing for us to think about what made sense in programming there.
And is the STEM a required elective?
Isn't it in sixth and seventh? And then it's choice. So in
sixth
and seventh grade, as we think about electives, you know, we have a great elective teacher here in with us today. They do such a great job of giving kids those experiences in sixth and seventh grade. So yes, it is part of sixth and seventh, and then becomes part of some of those like more tailored choices when they get into eighth grade.
I could be wrong, but I don't know that it is required in seventh. I know for sure it is in sixth. Don't they choose their electives
in
seventh?
Have ISR?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
In my okay
they
then.
Their
Got it, got it. So if they have ISR, then they don't get as many electives. Yes, okay. That's my experience then.
Any other questions from board members?
Is the STEM program at the junior high connected with Project Lead the Way? Is that?
It has experiences like Project Lead the Way. Okay. It doesn't use that specific curriculum.
Okay.
But as we move forward with the elementary program over the next couple of years, it is definitely something that we're interested in looking at for the STEP experiences in elementary. And so that may also help to inform NBJH, because they do get Project Lead the Way as an opportunity in high school.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It's an action item?
This is an action item.
Okay, so we'll pause the presentation for now. Is there a motion to approve the science resources as indicated?
So moved.
Second.
I'm sorry, we approve. I have a question.
Sorry.
Beef Tank was the second.
Okay.
Are we approving the dollar amount? What are we approving?
Correct. We are approving the contract to adopt the science materials curriculum.
Okay, then I have a question.
Yes.
So you said there were 12 hours of training, and is it provided by the practitioners at Smithsonian, and is that included in the amount?
Yes. So the 6 hours, so there's the second 6 hours. Is that what you're talking about? Yeah. So that is provided by Smithsonian, and it's part of your purchase.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Proceed. Yes.
Okay. Member Silvershack?
Aye.
Member Beeftink?
Aye.
Member Arms?
Aye.
Member Weinstock?
Aye.
Member Cassidy?
Aye.
President Gallinson?
Aye.
And absent is Member Baser.
Thank you. Are we ready to move on to the next slide?
Part
with
two.
World? Part two, world
part
language.
Part two,
thank
world
you.
Language, yep. I'll try to make this one a little shorter. So as you're aware, the World Language Committee is in year one of the committee process of reviewing our world language programming. Our World Language Committee consists of all of the world language teachers in our district, as well as representatives from GBN, including a teacher and the instructional supervisor. In March, we talked about these guiding questions that we have for our committee work. So looking at the purpose and goals of the World Language Program in our district, thinking about course pathways that we want for student learning, and the possibility for offering Spanish 2, the high school course at NBJH. We looked at the data, achievement data, and wanted to understand whether or not our kids were currently highly successful, and gather information through surveys and focus groups from our families, our teachers, and our students. So as we reviewed, I'm going to talk specifically about some of the survey information. When we sent the family survey, we had 578 families respond, which is a really high response rate. Mm-hmm. And it was very clear to us that parents were super supportive of the fact that we start world language learning early. So two of the questions that really kind of jumped out at us when we looked at the results, one was how strongly parents agreed with the statement, learning a language is important for future success. And 95% of our parents agreed that world language learning is important for their students or their child's future success. We also asked specifically how important it was for students to start learning a world language in elementary school. And 91% of our parents strongly agreed to the statement, it's important for students to start learning a world language in elementary school. Our program is pretty unique. We often take phone calls from folks around the state saying, you know, you're one of the only districts that starts this world language FLES program in first grade, and how do you do it, and what does it look like, and that kind of thing. So we feel like offering that for our students really is a gift for our students, and is highly supported by our families. The World Language Department put together a purpose statement as we reflected on our goals for our program. And I just want to highlight a few things that's in this purpose statement. And again, this was created by our amazing teachers on our committee. So the first idea is that the purpose of the program is really to enable students to communicate in a world language with cultural competency. So two big pieces in that statement. We want them to develop the ability to use language, to communicate with another language, but also with cultural competency. So that piece of learning, understanding culture, learning empathy, learning differences is very much a part of the experiences that we want for our students. The second thing that I wanted to highlight, and we've talked about this before, is we're doing our English language arts or literacy review at the same time that we're doing our world language review, because we think that the two go hand in hand. We know that students learning another language deepens that student's understanding about how language works. So not only are they developing communication skills in French or in Spanish, but also deepening their understanding of how English works. Beyond learning language, we also want to develop kids' critical thinking. And we know that world language learning, the way that we do it in the school district, helps kids to develop critical thinking and their skills in reading, writing, speaking, and listening in the world language. And finally, it's very important to our team that we develop students who want to be lifelong language learners. So it's not a goal for us to rush students through language learning. We want kids to enjoy learning language as elementary students, flourish as junior high students, want to continue to develop their language learning through high school, and hopefully college and beyond for the rest of their lives. So in thinking through the experiences that we want for kids, we want to make sure that they're gaining confidence, that they're finding it to be highly enjoyable, and that they're getting the correct level of challenge at the point in which they need it. So as a committee, as we thought about what we're doing with students currently to make sure that they have the appropriate level of challenge, students are receiving world language instruction from first grade through sixth grade at what we would call grade level instruction. And then after sixth grade, students who need more challenge in their curriculum are in an honors pathway so that they have an honors 7 and an honors 8 course. Other students who don't or aren't ready for that same level of challenge then have on grade level world language instruction. So proposed for implementation in the year 2024-25 is to kind of take that same course pathway, but to do some revision work in the curriculum next year so that students who previously had been in the honors course pathway and who are interested in taking that high school course as eighth graders are given the opportunity to enter that course and have an accelerated, more compacted curriculum so that they can then have the Spanish 2 course as eighth graders and then enter into the high school in the Spanish 3 level. So again, some students are ready for that level of challenge. Some students are interested in that level of challenge. Some students' needs are best met with the on-grade level world language learning experiences. So going into next year, year 2 of our curriculum work, we're thinking about and working with GBN around how do we revise our current honors courses to create that pathway for students who would demonstrate that readiness for Spanish 2 as eighth graders. Our GBN colleagues have been awesome, as have been our township colleagues, around helping us think about what we're providing, the experiences we're providing currently, what our curriculum looks like currently, and then how to make those adjustments. We also, as a team, want to create some procedures to identify students who really need that accelerated course pathway in terms of their skill development and their readiness, but also in terms of their interest in having a more accelerated and compacted a curriculum earlier on and taking that high school course as eighth graders. So students and families also have to think about sort of that idea of course load. If they are taking geometry, for example, which is a second high school course as eighth graders, and taking advanced language arts, they need to reflect on, you know, whether or not they would be interested in also managing the more accelerated track, the higher level of homework, you know, those kinds of expectations that come around taking a high school course as an eighth grader. And then finally, we always work backwards. So we look at GBN, curriculum at GBN, how does that impact what we will offer here at MBJH? And then how does that impact the adjustments that we want to make in elementary so that we make sure that our students, whichever course pathway they're on, can be highly successful, engaged, inspired learners who want to continue to pursue world language learning, hopefully throughout their lives.
Thank
what questions
so
do you have for us?
I have a question. The world language sort of phraseology here starts as world language, but ultimately it's focused on Spanish.
Right.
So what's the story?
The research would has us look at the number of hours that students are learning a language. And when we looked at the number of hours that students would be learning Spanish starting as first graders, we feel very confident that by making adjustments, we can successfully offer Spanish 2 for students as eighth graders. Our French program is extraordinary, but our French program does not have the number of hours because students don't start it until sixth grade. And so in that course pathway in French, we wouldn't offer the high school course at this time, just because of the number of hours and the research that helps us to understand how important the amount of practice you can get in and the number of hours that students are receiving instruction.
So what are the, on the track map that you had, it's confusing to me because you've got accelerated Spanish and Spanish 2, and then you just have the baseline grade 6, 7, 8. Mm-hmm. Does that mean that there's going to be a sort of a baseline Spanish, baseline French, and then also accelerated Spanish? Is there still going to be an honors French or not? Is there still going to be honor? I'm not sure how many tracks, because I think it's more than the two you're showing.
At this point, we're not making recommendations to change the French course pathways at all.
Okay.
So this is an adjustment to the Spanish course pathway in order to provide that high school course.
So French will remain honors 7 and honors 8 option.
So I have a question.
At this time, again, we're in year one, so we'll continue to have conversations, but at this time we haven't recommended a change to French.
I have more questions about the pathway
sure.
for Spanish. So that can you put up that the pathway? There we go. So we have in the current, you have grade 6, honor 7, honors 8. Then the proposed grade 6 accelerated Spanish. What is the difference between honor 7 and accelerated Spanish? And are there students then who are kind of in between, who are at the honors level but not necessarily ready or interested in the pathway to Spanish 2 or then Spanish 3 by high school?
Mm-hmm.
What about those kids?
So the honors course currently goes deeper in the language. Mm-hmm. An accelerated course will compact more content in a smaller amount of time. So students who are in the on grade level course, if they are ready for deeper instruction, could be differentiated within that on grade level course and their needs could still be met with the new pathway. Students who are in that accelerated, it really is more content in a smaller amount of time. They have to demonstrate that readiness in order to take the high school course. So in that way, it is different. Again, the honors really goes deeper, gives kids experiences that's closer to the on grade level content, but just in a different way that
right.
will challenge them differently.
Do you expect there to be the similar number of students in the accelerated Spanish as there are currently in honors? I'm wondering if that's going to sort of be looked at as, I have strength in Spanish, so therefore I will go to accelerated. Whereas that's really a different course now than the current honors.
Mm-hmm. So some of this is, as we work on this, making sure that families understand the differences and understand what this course expects and the experiences that the kids will have in the course, so that families can have conversations with their students about their interest. We'll determine readiness through assessments that we provide students to figure out what their skill level is, and to figure out, even to some degree, those sort of studenting skills and, and motivation skills that would allow them to be successful in a high school course as an eighth grader.
What do you expect? I'm not expecting actual numbers, but what are you expecting, you know, going forward in comparison to what we have now, as far as, you know, honors versus, if that's, you know, no longer an option, the honors versus accelerated going forward?
When we think, when we're, when we're thinking about our students who are currently in the honors course pathway, we think that many of those, most of those students could probably be successful in the Spanish 2 course pathway going forward. Mm-hmm. So three sections, possibly.
And
two
there are
sections.
How many now?
So
of honors?
I think there's three.
Okay.
Two to three?
Four next year.
Four next year.
Okay.
Depending on class size.
And one more question. Currently, we see the pathway through eighth grade. Mm-hmm. For those that are in honors in eighth grade, currently, what is then the next step in high school versus what is potentially the next step next year for those that are in Spanish 2 in eighth grade versus maybe a high achieving core eighth grade Spanish kid who, you know, maybe would have just been in honors, you know, previously.
Mm-hmm. So for students who are on the on grade level track, it's the same as it is currently, where they would go into 263 or 273, 273 being their honors track. And the same with if we offer Spanish 2 here, students would go into 363 or 373, depending on their readiness. It's sort of the same placement process that is currently in place, where our teachers in collaboration with the high school think about the right placement for students. So level Spanish 2 versus Spanish 3, either the on-grade level, I think they call it regular, or the honors course.
So just let me see if I understand this. So the placement, the pathway where they can potentially end up in high school is not necessarily different. It just may prepare more students to potentially reach level 3?
Currently we don't have we have just a few. The small handful of students going into Spanish 3. This would prepare more students.
This prepares more.
For Spanish 363 or 373.
My only reservation, and I, you know, this may be unfounded, but I'm just wondering if, you know, kind of exchanging the honors for the accelerated is going to leave some students out. Mm-hmm. You know, for where they may be most successful or challenged.
Mm-hmm. And it is something that the committee has talked about.
Yeah.
When we think about math, for example, there's three pathways in
math.
And so we have talked about three pathways. We'll come back, we'll continue that discussion. But at this point, we feel like we can meet students' needs in two pathways. We feel like the differentiation that happens in that on grade level course that gives kids who are ready for that sort of deeper experience within that classroom, we feel like we can still do that. But it will be an ongoing conversation with us so that we make sure that we are providing the right course pathways to give kids the right level of challenge at the right time.
And a kid who takes Spanish 2 in eighth grade could potentially then just do honors or Spanish 2 in high school. They don't necessarily have to go on to Spanish 3. Correct?
But most students will, because
they'll be ready.
We'll have that high school course, and so they won't want to repeat that high school course. But it still could be an option for a student.
I have a question about the current sixth graders. So this will be 24, 25. So they will be in eighth grade. How will they be handled?
just like math.
It's just like math, where we have to like look at the cohorts. Sorry. We'll have to, when we made course adjustments in math, we had a cohort who was sixth graders into seventh. Mm-hmm. And so we had that year where we had still had four course pathways in seventh grade for those kiddos as our sixth graders were coming in with three course pathways. So, you know, we would just have to keep our sixth graders on the course pathway that, you know, they sort of started that trajectory with, and obviously continuing to differentiate and do the things that we're doing for them right now. But they would be entering as sixth graders, so we would allow them to move through the course pathway as seventh graders and eighth graders, and then the incoming sixth graders would start the suggested proposed course pathway.
So the current, all the current students as well as the incoming sixth graders will stay on the current path, and then the...
Yeah, so this proposed would be that year's incoming sixth graders would start that course pathway. So we would have the seventh and eighth graders, those given years, working through the course pathway as it,
as
you know,
it will be.
Right,
okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Have you thought, I mean, of perhaps even, you know, taking into account what Mara had said, stacked class with the honors as an option? If students are finding the accelerated or the Spanish 2 a little too challenging, but still wanting to stay engaged in Spanish.
What does that mean,
stacked classroom?
Where you have your kind of differentiating, where students can remain in that class, but it may instruct a lot of foreign language classrooms end up having to do that for staffing reasons.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's differentiating within that on grade level course pathway.
Right.
I think that's very
possible.
Very much so.
Yeah.
Can you remind us when you look at neighbor districts, are they more in line with the current approach or the proposed approach?
So I'm doing this off the top of my head. District 30 starts world language learning at third grade, and they follow our current course pathways within honors and within on grade level. District 27 starts world language learning at sixth grade, and after sixth grade they do like we are proposing to do, where they split into an accelerated course that leads into Spanish 2 as eighth graders. I don't know, 31 That's and 34.
Fair enough. And do you know if they do that for French as well, an accelerated
pathway? I don't believe so.
The French students from Porto, so from 27, rarely go into 363. Most of them go into 263 or 270.
Thank you.
It's like here, the number of students that we place into a 300 level. What else is similar in our French students?
And just as a reminder, we work closely with our township districts, but because a particular district down the street follows a particular model or handles of their curriculum or whatever decisions they make, doesn't necessarily mean that we would do the same thing, though we certainly have conversations about what their experiences are and how their students are doing as they move through the years.
My question is about the elementary curriculum, mm-hmm. if the proposed changes stick for the junior high school. So because we have this new option, it's accelerated and you get to do Spanish too, which is great. Based on at least the one example that you gave of the benchmarking with 27, they don't start until sixth grade, but yet they have eighth graders taking Spanish too. I hear what you're saying about the survey results, and that parents are glad that language starts in elementary school. What kind of feedback did you get about how early it starts and starting all the way, and I'm saying that on purpose, in first grade versus third grade or fourth grade? I'm not surprised that 91% would be positive about it starting in elementary. I am surprised, just based upon my own network of parents, that they would be so positive to start at first grade.
That is a great question. So part of this year one work, as we were thinking about the research around second language learning, and for many of our kids it's third and fourth language learning, the earlier you start, the more successful you are. So when we look at brain research and we look at the sort of the plasticity that develops in the brain when a child learns language at a very early age, based on brain scans, it's really impressive what happens in terms of the child's ability to think, literally think differently, because of the pathways that are built in their brains. We feel like in this district that we want to provide that opportunity for our kids, because we know the long-term effects that it has on a student's learning, on a student's ability to learn language, but also on a student's ability to think more creatively, to develop critical thinking and that kind of thing. So we didn't ask parents specifically on the survey what grade they thought it should start in, but we certainly did discuss as a committee how early language learning should start. And the research would really say if it could start with the newborn, that would be the very best opportunity that we could give kids to develop their mental acuity and their understanding how language works and cultural understanding and that kind of thing.
And can you just remind us how much they actually get in first and second grades, time-wise? 30, because I hear what you're saying.
Yeah, 30 minutes daily through elementary school.
Chris, I'm wondering if, because that's something that I hear too, is, you know, the idea I think is really easy to kind of sign on for. You know, the earlier the better, absolutely. I'm wondering, you talk about an education piece with the junior high parents in terms of, you know, that the pathway for language in high school. Mm-hmm. I'm wondering if we can also talk about an education piece for elementary parents. Sure. I think it would be helpful for parents to understand that the instruction that students are getting at the younger grade levels is meaningful. Mm-hmm. I think that is an element that may be missing for some parents, to understanding that it is meaningful and how.
And that's part of the curriculum review process, whether we're doing science or social studies or literacy or visual arts, whatever it is building in that another fresh look at the purpose and being more clear with our purpose, and then making the curricular changes, and then making sure that we really clearly communicate to families what has happened, the process that's taken place, but also the changes that are forthcoming.
I
because
that
there will be adjustments to the elementary curriculum in year two, as there is in every curricular area that we look at when we're working with the committee. And so we also want to make sure that parents know the adjustments that were made, as you said, not just at the junior high, but also in the elementary program and the purpose of the elementary, and some of that brain research that's so fascinating that maybe hasn't been shared for quite a number of years.
Beyond the brain research, but actually, you know, like throughout the grades, maybe, you know, this is what we're focusing on in these grades.
Right.
You know, beyond just this is good for them, this is good for, you know, for the brain. I think would be helpful, because I think it's there. I think the communication piece is maybe missing.
Sure.
And I think that would help a lot with, you know, support and more buy-in.
Sure. Sure. There is tons of support. We can always do more. We can always do more in terms of helping parents to feel like they know the goals of the program. They know how their students are doing, how their students are performing, and even proficiency levels.
Right.
We'll do some communication around ACFL proficiency levels.
Mm-hmm.
All of that it's the right time to do all that through our curriculum review work, through our committee work.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, sorry. So I know it's getting late, but I my own opinion from what I have heard from my peers is, you know, it's too early. The amount of time that could be spent on some other things. And, you know, what you have said about the brain and the earlier you start is good for, you know, learning the language and critical thinking, that type of thing. But it's also a little bit in contradiction to what we talked about in the previous update around the goals of the Spanish program being more cultural, having them have the cultural worldview, which of course is good. So I would just encourage you guys, as you're moving into wave two, to think about, if we're going to stay this early, do we, like, is it one or the other? Do you start with the cultural awareness and then get into the language learning, you know, at a different time, or is it all together? Just because I hear what you're saying, but it's not really playing out in the opinions that I have heard. So, yeah, maybe digging a little bit deeper into that survey to see what either, you know, other ideas that there are, or when we're going out to the parents that with whatever is recommended that we're addressing those concerns.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. We appreciate that input. We sure will.
Great. Well, there's nothing else. Dr. Reitzer and Michelle, this has been an amazing presentation, and to your teams and to all the teachers who have spent so much time researching,
yes. Mm-hmm.
And the high school who's been so
yes.
generous with
they
their time.
Amazing.
We are appreciative of your efforts. So thank you for your presentation and thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Okay. Buildings and grounds, Jessica?
Sure, I just wanted to give you guys a short little update on the summer projects. We've been approving them here at the board table and talking about them month over month, but we thought it'd be a good idea to kind of get them in one fell swoop what we have going on this summer. Big projects include a rooftop replacement at Greenbrier that'll air condition the auditorium at that space. You approved that last month. That unit is officially now ours, more than a post-it note, and we are on schedule to start that work after July 1. Joel is busy scheduling the junior high's gym wall, divider wall for the installation of a fabric curtain in that space. Also in that space, they're currently painting that, so it'll be brighter, as well as district-wide we have a lighting upgrade, so new lighting in there too. So that space should look really fresh when the kids come back for the next school year. Also here at the junior high, we have the elevators being replaced here in the main area. District-wide, the lighting project I just mentioned. Yesterday was the zoning hearing for the installation variance for the fence at the Westmore Playground. Just to reiterate or talk about that project a little bit, we have the right to put in a 3-foot fence in that space, and we were looking to go a little higher for the protection of the students. We applied for a 5-foot fence. We were approved for 4-foot and ornamental. So Joel right now has one additional quote with the different variants, and it's $6,000 additional dollars for that. So we're going to kind of look at a couple of different vendors again for that work. We have some various small projects throughout the district, the garden gates here, some drywall work, some pipe installation, new kiln, art teacher in the room, some terrazzo repair here. So lots of little odds and ends, and that's in addition to the deep cleaning the crew does and all of the other upkeep throughout the building.
Great, thank you. Matt, anything on the legislation side?
Lots of smaller things that are going to come out through policy committee that are changed to the school code. The only one that I want to highlight is which passed both chambers of the Illinois House and Senate and is headed towards the governor's desk, is the mandate to inform families within 24 hours that are involved in any kind of a bullying report. Having passed both chambers of the legislature, I don't know of any indication of what the governor will do, whether he'll sign it or not. But if he does, that will certainly, you know, require some changes here, and anywhere. So that's the one I wanted to make sure we highlighted. The wording within the bill is that is within 24 hours after the school's administration is made aware of the incident, they have to inform families. And everything else is just stuff I think will come through the wash in the policy committee.
Great, thank you. Anything specifically on policy?
No.
Any updates, Dr. Pearson, on policy?
Yeah, actually, we have a very robust packet to review for policy committee, so we'll be bringing several policies forward. I'm at the June meeting, and I believe we have a meeting scheduled in the next couple of weeks to go through that.
Great. Thank you. And Terry, communications.
Well, good evening, everyone. Just to highlight a few of the items in my report, work is really moving forward on transitioning the website. I've done a couple of onboarding meetings as well as working on the template, and it'll have a fresh look, a fresh navigation using the guidance that I've received from the surveys from both parents and staff. Celebrate 28. Thank you to those who could attend, and it went over very well, I think. The new venue was well received. We had nearly 200 guests to recognize our years of service and our class of 2023 retirees. I list in my report several of the highlights that have been in the news and social media, including Wendy Conklin's and the MBJH Health Education Blue Ribbon, Jeremy Bartunek, our music educator at Greenbrier, making it as a quarter finalist in the Music Educator Grammy Award, and our HOH scholarship winners. We were announced at the Glenbrook North on Friday, and we'll be highlighting them in graduation on Thursday at our eighth grade. They are invited to come and be recognized there. We have published our possibly last podcast for the school year on fifth grade musicals. It was a lot of fun to talk to kids before and after they went on stage, and the value that the music directors place on the experience and all the work that goes into that. So that was a unique way to share that. And starting to work on the biannual community newsletter, which will be published before we meet again. That goes out to all of the residents in the community, and it's kind of just a, you know, biannual update. We'll feature our facilities master planning, our graduates who were recognized, and a lot of the news from the past semester. Any questions?
I wasn't able to attend Celebrate 20, but I saw the video. It was really very nice. So
glad you liked
it. Good job. And should the full board expect to see the newsletter before it goes out, or do you just send it to?
No.
Nobody. Okay.
I usually work with the superintendent, and usually okay. I previously we had one member review it, the board president usually.
Okay. Thank you. Sure, I make time for it.
Thanks. Great, and a big thank you to Terry and Chrissy for their support in pulling off a fantastic event at a new venue with a new format. The feedback was very positive, and everyone had a fantastic time. So thank you for your creativity and all of your hard work. And Jessica, FOIA, I think, goes back to you. Is that correct?
Yeah. Yeah, so we received a few FOIAs, the details of which were in the packet. The University of Kentucky one was for data that they intended from the high school only. The Lurie Children's Hospital was denied as unduly burdensome and containing a lot of sensitive information.
Thank you. True North, Mara, did you attend the previous month's meeting?
So I was not in attendance at this last meeting. No. So the report is as it stands.
As indicated.
As indicated.
Okay. And I should note for the record that we are in transition with our committees, so that we will be replacing Mara on that committee. So thank you for your service previously, Mara. Is there any new business? Okay. We will now move into closed session. There's a recommendation that we go into closed session to discuss the appointment, employment, compensation, discipline, performance, or dismissal of specific employees of the district or legal counsel for the district, including testimony on a complaint lodged against an employee or against legal counsel for the district to determine its validity as authorized by statute, collective negotiating matters between the district and its employees or their representatives, or deliberations concerning salary schedules for one or more classes of employees as authorized by statute, and the placement of individual students in special education programs and other matters relating to individual students as per statute. Do I have a motion to go into closed session?
So moved.
Second.
As there is no new business and no business that will be conducted after the closed session, we will close the recording with our appreciation to the tech team and to everyone who attended today. Can we get a roll call on the motion to close session?
Yes. Member Silvershack?
Aye.
Member Arms?
Aye.
Member Beefcheek?
Aye.
Member Cassidy?
Aye.
Member Weinstock?
Aye.
And President Gallinson?
Aye.
And absent is Member Baser.
Aye.